What's going on, everybody? A great weekend of football. The fantasy playoffs are nearly here, and we cover all the studs and the duds and the news and reaction to last night's game and a whole lot more. Do not miss it. Leave a comment, like, subscribe. Enjoy.
The holidays can be hectic, but preparing festive meals just got easier. Now you can cut out the grocery shopping and limit meal prep time with HelloFresh. Get up to 14 free meals plus 3 free gifts with code FOOTBALLERS14 at HelloFresh.com/FOOTBALLERS14.
Foot Clan, it's that time of year where we're looking towards the future a little bit, looking at ourselves going, hey, can I improve this situation? Can I get a little bit more healthy? And that comes with working out. And Echelon, they bring the gym home. Echelon is the affordable way to get the workout equipment, the workout community, and an instructor's motivation right in the comfort of your home. The Echelon Fitness app provides you thousands of live and on-demand classes with great music. And with Echelon, you can work out anytime, day, night. Crush those fitness goals. Just pick your class, climb the leaderboard, cheer each other on, and give it your all. Echelon has a full range of affordable workout equipment, including stationary bikes, smart rowers, sleek fitness screens, and the auto-folding treadmill. And they're all connected to provide the Echelon experience. Right now, for a limited time, our listeners can get up to $800 off MSRP. To get this exclusive podcast discount, text FANTASY to 818181. Text FANTASY to 818181 to get up to $800 off MSRP. Text FANTASY to 818181. Message and data rates may apply. See terms for details.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Welcome in. Monday, December 13th, the Fantasy Footballers Podcast, Mike Wright, Jason Moore, Andy Holloway here. One more game left in week 14, but many of you out there may know your playoff position already.
Did you get in? I hope so.
Do a little dance.
Mm-hmm.
Make a little love.
Did you get the bye?
Get down tonight.
I hope so.
I didn't, because Al took it.
Yeah.
Al took the bye, and he did it with all the points. I was hoping he needed to. I took care of my business, and Al needed to lose, and I could have taken the bye back. But then,
whoopsies. Yeah. Al's team went nuclear this week, and all I needed was another 100 points, and I could have caught him.
Yeah, he had a big week. It's not even over. The Cardinals play the Rams tonight in Arizona. Two-thirds of this crew here will be at the game, so you two gentlemen will enjoy that in person. Hopefully the Cardinals can win a game at home, because that's they've only lost two games this year, and they've both been at home. Hmm. One to Carolina.
Well, don't say that.
And well, you got to right the ship. You weren't. I mean, I guess we were there for one of them. I was going to say we weren't there, but we were. I remember that. Al liked that night. But
also, I believe
it would be the first team to clinch the playoffs. Cardinals are not technically clinched yet.
I believe that the Minnesota victory was also at home, which, if you remember, we yes. should not have won that game because Minnesota missed a chip shot field goal to lose.
There was a lot of fun things that happened this week in fantasy football, and we'll get into all the studs on the show and talk through the duds. There's some injury news you need to know about. I mean, you're kind of holding your breath. If this week didn't matter that much to you getting into the playoffs, then it was like, please don't get hurt, my players. And some of them did, and we'll talk about that as well. You can find us on Twitter at the FF Ballers. We once again put the thread out on Twitter looking for the best puns of the weekend. Let's get sophisticated.
Hmm. Yes. No. Well, who is that? Is that Melvin Scordum?
Oh, that's not a...
Did you put an M at the end of that?
Oh, it's a long N.
Okay. How about Travis Kills Me?
How about Derek the Garbage Man?
Mm.
Send in the garbage. Icky Seals Jones.
Oh. Or Ricky Seals Groans.
Dalton Chucks.
Dalton Charts.
Oh, come on. Or maybe maybe you got No Mixin.
Or what about Rashad Dollar?
Cha-ching.
That's a Jason one.
Yeah,
he loves
love
those ones.
Hunter Renfro.
Or Funter Renfro.
And Taysom Bills.
Mm. Man, what?
Dollar Bills, yo. He has taken the mantle from Jalen Hurts as the worst quarterback great at fantasy. I mean,
he wasn't even good the whole game.
No, he was terrible. He was awful the entire game. Yeah, he should have been way better against the Jets. Of course, he was. What is he the number one quarterback on the week? No,
I don't
probably
know,
Herbert
so.
And
Big Ben's up there.
Aaron Rodgers. Yes, your start of the week, Big Ben. But it's just ridiculous when you can rush for. Did he get 100 rushing yards? He was close.
Well, that last touchdown run was so late in the game, and they just. The defense was like, eh.
Did you hear what Alvin Kamara said about it?
No.
Yeah.
I did.
Yeah.
No, I didn't hear this.
He said, your blank should have gone down and stayed in bounds.
Wow.
But Taysom wanted the fantasy stats.
He wanted them points.
All right. Thank you, Taysom. You were played by many. Jointhefoot.com is the fantasy football community. Get the extra weekly show. Tons of tools and resources. Let's get into the news.
News and notes from around the league, presented by Sleeper.
Well, we did get news ahead of kickoff that Jets rookie phenom wide receiver Elijah Moore was placed on IR.
Yeah. Unfortunate.
That stinks. But going into next year, we can't forget how good he was. We need to remember that going into next year that he broke out.
Mm-hmm.
DeAndre Swift, rumors swirling that he is a candidate to be placed on injured reserve, not to help you in your fantasy playoffs. That is another disappointing piece of news for those counting on him in the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like you should. If you're the Lions, you got your W. Yep. Now you're playing for next year.
Derrick Henry's supposed to come back, but it won't matter to your fantasy team. The earliest would be Week 18 against the Texans, likely for the NFL playoffs. But not the fantasy playoffs. Hopefully he stays healthy. There's a re-injury risk with that foot. This weekend, you also had the COVID dance going on with Daryl Henderson, Miles Gaskin, Jamal Williams, David Johnson, and then Keenan Allen didn't play due to COVID-19. This is going to be something that impacts the fantasy playoffs. Because
it will.
Every week you are getting a handful of surprises and with the winter season, what's going on around the country and the case numbers, it's inevitable that you're going to have some of these players test positive. And so this is just, hope it's not your guy. I mean, Jamal Williams, we thought he'd be playing this week. David Johnson, we thought you might be able to sneak him in an emergency, and they were both surprise inactives. Daryl Henderson had the injury, we were wondering, but now you know he's out tonight against Arizona.
Yeah, the Keenan Allen plays on Thursday night. He missed this last week. Brandon Staley expects him to be back, so that's good news.
Yeah, that's going to be quite the – for the fantasy playoffs, many people starting this week, and you're going to start with Chiefs, Chargers, Thursday night football. I mean
– oh, baby.
The Chargers played well again. Herbert's been on fire. Mahomes, the offense, getting it together for the Chiefs. So many fantasy players throughout that game. And one of them, we hope, will be back out there. Austin Eckler, who left with an ankle injury, says he expects to be fine moving forward. Brandon Staley said he could have returned to the game if necessary. I don't quite buy this because I still think there's a chance he's back for Thursday, but you just don't know how these things respond.
If he was going to return, it was going to be with a mummy foot because they spent about 15 minutes and 10 rolls of tape just going over this ankle over and over and over until it was about four times the size it's supposed to be.
He still has not been able to get the shoe off. They're trying to get the tape off. It's
now part of him.
Yeah, it is who he is now. But yeah, I mean, we see this all the time. Guys, even when they come back in the game and they play after the ankle injury, day two, day three, the ankle swells up and it gets worse. So it's really hard to say, like, oh, we know his ankle's good already.
These players tape up the ankles a little bit before anyway, right? Like,
yeah.
They go into games with them. All right. They don't just risk it. I was like, because we should pre-tape.
Yeah, well, when you pre-tape, then you lose some of the
agility,
the flexibility that you have. You just put your ankles a little more protected.
Kareem Hunt, also an ankle injury.
Yeah.
Also a head coach that says he could have come back in the game. Lamar Jackson, Mike, ruled out early. Mike's luck continues.
Look.
Mike's fantasy season continues.
Yes, yes. Yes, thank you.
Lamar to the left.
So, we'll do it quickly because I've been.
Do we have to?
Yes. I was heading into the final week here. I want to get this W, you know, let's salvage something in the final week. I'm still trying to win. Keenan Allen, oh, he's out. Okay, how do I respond? I'm going KJ Osborne. Big game. Like right off the waiver wire.
Well done. Nice maneuvering.
Like took care of
coach.
That. Heading into the weekend, Jamal Williams, he's going to be my guy. I've had him all year for this moment. Oh, and he's a surprise inactive. But fear not, for I picked up Rashad Penny.
Oh, baby.
Off of the news that he could be truly the 1A. He had the 10 carries this last week. I have stashed the Tennessee Titans defense for 3 weeks just for this moment against the Jacksonville Jaguars.
They were great.
My team is going off.
All you need.
All I need is a quarterback.
Just to score some points.
You know what? Just give me, Lamar, that worst game of the year that you already had. And he said, no, I will be the one quarterback catastrophe of the season. I saved it just for you, Mike. Just for you. 1 point.
And
come on.
Some of our League of Record members have already sent you gifts this morning for that defeat.
Yeah. Yeah.
So gonna be a long off season for
Goodness
Mike
gracious.
The fantasy hitman. Taylor Heinicke exited early. They're optimistic he'll be back. That game became very fun at the end. Terry McLaurin exited with a concussion. That was less fun. Had he done anything
no,
before
full,
that?
He, full goose. He goosed. And his concussion.
Oh, I feel bad doing that on a concussion, but
well,
that
sure.
was late.
He played half the game. He played 49% of the snaps. So in half the game did nothing. And it was not his fault.
That's a full bust season now for McLaurin.
Yes.
Yeah. And yes. Heinicke, though, in this game, I know he had the one crazy touchdown to Cam Sims, I believe it was. But up until that point, Heinicke was awful. He played terrible football, including the ambulance ball that he threw to Terry McLaurin. That McLaurin was trying to bail him out by snatching this thing 25 feet out of the air. Unfortunately, got undercut and lands on his head.
Do you think after watching that performance, Matt Rhule's like, oh, yeah, I want that guy.
Yeah,
I could really turn this around.
Upgrade. we thought we were seeing replays over and over because every time we looked, the Dallas Cowboys defenders were just tipping the ball around because it was always just almost an interception.
There's talk of Matt Rhule not making it through the season in Carolina.
Wow.
There's a different coach who should not make it through the season.
Yeah, I mean, but just speaking to the Carolina reaction to the weekend, I mean, what on earth is wrong with you? I mean, the snip, snap, back forth between two quarterbacks after you already, and you spent all this money on Darnold, he was a flop. You didn't spend a draft pick on Justin Fields. I don't know. It's a mess in Carolina.
This is a situation where they're on the cusp of the playoffs and desperate for a win. They're not looking for the future. This is, I want to win now. And when you're in a winnable game against the Falcons and you're playing poorly, you're not going to wait the whole game. So that's, I understand making the, like, look, we've got to win and we got to win now. So they make the switch, hoping that that can be the spark to get him the victory. But then PJ Walker was worse. It was like, oh gosh, what do we do? I mean, there's no winning there. It's not like any that they don't have a quarterback.
Here's the truth. They're not good. They're a bad team.
I think they're a good defense.
They're 2-8 in their last 10 games. Their wins to start the year, let's remember who they were.
Sure.
The
okay,
Jets,
that's fair.
The yep. Texans, mm-hmm. and the Saints. That game was impressive. But the Jets and the Texans were not – I didn't realize they were in a 2-8 tailspin. Like, that's why those rumors are circling. And what's their future? You know, it's like – I don't know if they should make a change or not, but they don't seem to know what they're doing, is my point.
Yeah, I do think it's mostly a horrific quarterback situation, but I don't know that they're going to be able to solve it. I mean, lots of teams have bad quarterback situations for many, many years, and they always wish they could fix it, but it might take getting that number one pick, because if you don't land an Aaron Rodgers in a trade or Deshaun Watson, it's just they don't grow on trees.
You're right. Yeah, they don't. Josh Allen dealing with a mild case of turf toe. My reaction to it was not mild, however. Going into the fantasy playoffs, you have a difficult matchup against that Carolina defense, at least statistically speaking, next week. So, you know, number one quarterback this week, Josh Allen, ran for 109 yards.
It was absurd, too, because he was, I feel like, three quarters of the way through this game, he was not anywhere close to the number one quarterback, but then he did Josh Allen stuff.
54 pass attempts. He's been the number one quarterback in 5 of the last 11 weeks on the week. So how do you possibly – I mean, you just ride him, right? You just put him in.
He's the stallion, baby.
Yeah.
Oh, you do. Excellent. You do ride a stallion.
He does buck you off from time to time.
Yes, and he does.
With the turf toe, you know, he might miss a practice, but I mean, look, if Aaron Rodgers can play with it, I'm sure shattered toe, his foot barely works now. What a hero that he's playing through. Then I'm sure Josh Allen could play through a mild case of turf toe.
Did you want me to talk about Aaron Rodgers' broken toe reportedly feeling worse?
Oh man. But he looked great.
Look. The what stinks here for Aaron Rodgers, he's playing spectacular football.
Yes, he is.
And his toe could legitimately be awful. Like, if you've ever had a broken toe, it's excruciating, and there's nothing you can do about it except wait for your toe to be healed. But he has done some things, some interviews during this season that have caused the public to turn on him, so you just sound like a whiner. At this point, talking about the toe, even though I think it's a real thing. I think he has a busted toe, and it hurts, man.
It's probably the worst. He is playing great football, but nobody likes you anymore.
Well, part of it is, like, you don't look like you're hurt ever. So, I mean, it's a compliment if you are hurt.
Yeah.
But you would expect somebody, like, I remember the 2 games ago, he's like, oh, it's so bad. And he had just, like, he just juked a guy on the edge and ran it in for a touchdown and looked great. So you're like,
that's all heart, baby.
I mean, you might as well just say it's the worst thing ever, even if it's not. Melvin Gordon sprained thumb, doesn't figure to limit his playing time. He was awesome.
He was.
The Broncos running backs were number 3 and 6 on the week, at least the last time I had looked. Gordon was 3, Williams was 6. They are both playing good football. Emmanuel Sanders ruled out with a knee injury. This could be impactful if you were looking at, like, Gabriel Davis moving forward,
mm-hmm.
who's already started to work himself more into the he's scoring almost every week. And then what else? You still don't have Chase Edmonds activated for tonight's game.
We don't know yet. He could
okay.
be.
All right. Anything else, Brooksy?
No, sir.
You gentlemen,
Urban Meyer is the worst.
That's you the... even get you made it plural. All Urban Meyers?
Yeah.
You made it plural.
Yeah. He just fire him. Like, literally – don't let him get through the season. That would be my recommendation.
Yeah, but
I know
he's a winner.
Fun.
He's a winner.
I know it's fun for entertainment and for media. We have a good laugh. But I'm not. I don't even want the laugh. I just want them to move on from this.
At least Jeff Fisher was laugh like he was a. Oh, he was kind of like he was bad, but he kind of root for
him. Yeah, love Jeff Fisher. Who doesn't love Jeff Fisher?
Like, yeah, Jeff Fisher, just it felt like the league had passed on. And that happens to coaches. Like, the NFL is constantly changing shape, and if you don't, as a coach, adapt to those things, it will leave you behind. Urban Meyer was not ready for the NFL at any point.
I thought you could have also put the word Trevor Lawrence in there.
I don't know. Trevor Lawrence will be
or Zach Wilson.
Trevor Lawrence is going to be talked about a lot in this offseason of who's to blame for the catastrophic start for the rookie.
I'm fine heaping a ton of the blame on Urban Meyer, but if you're the Heisman winning number one pick and you've thrown one touchdown pass in now 6 weeks, one touchdown pass in 6 weeks.
He did throw four interceptions though this week.
Yeah.
So that's
do those cool. count?
Those do count for the other team if they score a touchdown.
So you would expect a player like that to usurp his situation a few times.
Yeah, I agree. But you also have a coach who takes the best offensive player off the field to punish him because he fumbled. And then he gets that player gets back on the field after the quarterback is like, "Hey, where is my best player?" And they're like, "Okay, fine. We'll take him out of timeout."
Well, we'll talk more about duds.
Crisscross applesauce, James Robinson. You get over there, crisscross applesauce right now.
I'm a winner. All right, that was today. We got a little venom today. I'm sorry. I'm seeing the producers nod. I don't know why. There's a little bit of venom today of you shooting shots at Aaron Rodgers' toe for no reason. That was today's news and notes brought to you by Sleeper, the leader in breaking news alerts. Grab the app, subscribe to the Breaking Alerts channel. Want to thank a couple of sponsors before we get into the studs, including our good friends, our deliciously good friends, ooh, Omaha Steaks. We're at the point now where we've been with Omaha Steaks for so long and eaten so much of their product that there are holiday memories that just they're fused together with Omaha Steaks, and getting that box on the doorstep with the dry ice and the burger. We just did Omaha Steaks burgers the other day. You've got caramel apple tartlets. That's part of my holiday from now on.
Omaha Steaks is part of who I am now.
What's nice right now, I mean, we're talking to you December 13th. There's so many things like, last minute, I might not get it. No, Omaha's ready to ship stuff right now. So this is the perfect gift. I mean, you want to get somebody another gift card to someplace, or do you want to get them a box full of delicious food on their doorstep? Finding that perfect gift, no longer tricky, makes it easy to send friends and family an unforgettable gift. Go to omahasteaks.com, enter footballers into the search bar, and save over 50% when you order the perfect gift package today. For $99.99, you'll get the world-famous bacon-wrapped filet mignons, chicken breasts, jumbo franks, sides, desserts, and so much more. When you use the code footballers, not only do you save 50%, you also get an additional 8 Omaha Steaks burgers for free. OmahaSteaks.com, keyword footballers in the search bar.
And we want to thank Indochino. Indochino could get your closet where you want it before the new year starts. I absolutely love Indochino as a brand. The suits, they fit perfectly because they are tailored perfectly for you. You can shop online, measure yourself. You can visit a showroom. That's what I did. It's amazing. You feel like royalty going in, having someone like, step on this box here. Yes. And then zip, zap, zip, you know, they do it all. And they really can help you customize different types of clothing as well. Their stuff is awesome. It's completely custom fitted. They've got suits, shirts, casual wear, and, you know, at surprisingly affordable prices. You can get a wardrobe personalized to your style and taste without spending a fortune. I ordered some button-up shirts, just button-up shirts that are perfectly tailored to my body. It's not like I'm getting a large or an extra large. I'm getting me. The best part is Indochino suits, they start from just $429 and shirts from $79 with all the customizations included. Give yourself a custom closet revamp with Indochino, or give the gift of great style with an Indochino gift card. Get $50 off any purchase of $399 or more using the promo code footballers at Indochino.com. That's $50 off a purchase of $399 or more at Indochino.com. Promo code footballers.
This week's Fantasy Stud Muffins.
All right, heading into the fantasy playoffs, let's talk about some of these players that did deliver for your teams, maybe won you a playoff spot. Josh Allen, we just talked about it, mentioned he's finished the QB1 five times. He only did it one time last year in the breakout season. So we've seen less consistency, but he's still the best quarterback out there right now for fantasy. That's a big deal. I mean, Lamar last in 2019, four times he did that. He's already passed that. So what are your thoughts on Allen going into the fantasy playoffs? Because this team is now on the cusp of missing the playoffs themselves.
I worry a little bit more about him. Like, I think I would rather have someone like Tom Brady, who maybe doesn't have the same ceiling. Obviously, the number one finishes, but in the
doesn't
playoff,
have the same floor either.
I feel like what we've seen lately with Josh Allen is like every other week he's not even a quarterback one, in which case this is the playoffs. You need three good weeks in a row, right? Like if you have a stinker, you can be out.
Brady's been number two for two straight weeks.
Yeah, and it's just, I guess I just worry because when you watch, like I know he had an awesome game, awesome. What a comeback, because they were down, I think, 21 points late in that game. But the point is they hadn't done anything, and we've seen it so often lately. Like, do you guys look at the Bills and say, like, great offense, just a dominant offense? Because that's how we thought they were, but I'm not sure that that's true.
I think they can be. They're just very streaky, where when things are off, it can take multiple quarters for them to figure it out. But normally Josh Allen figures it out.
Yeah.
And he can, in a quarter, he can produce an entire game's worth of fantasy points.
The nice thing is this is not only fantasy playoff time, but it is real have to win these games time for the Bills. Like, he's got a tough schedule coming up, but last year he had a tough schedule and he won everybody championships in that time of year, where like the Bills, they can't lollygag. They have to win these games if they want to make the playoffs.
I have to make the choice between Brady and Allen this week.
Carolina or the Saints. Carolina for Allen and the Saints for Tom Brady.
Both at home. Saints matchup is on paper better.
I don't go Brady.
Don't get it wrong.
Oh gosh.
So that's my advice.
This is
pick the right player.
That's pretty solid advice, Mike.
An abundance of riches, and now it's my curse.
Look, just don't get it wrong.
Tom Brady was awesome. Again, he's on pace for 47 passing touchdowns. He's playing the best football of his career, maybe. And this could be the best fantasy finish he ever has. Or, you know, it's crazy. Absolutely crazy. Aaron Rodgers, outstanding yet again. Baltimore next week. Ooh.
That turned into a very strange game.
That game was awesome.
This is the Green Bay Packers, Chicago Bears, NFC North divisional battle where the up north,
cold weather.
It's freezing outside in Lambeau, and it's 45-30.
Yeah, they scored like 40 points in 11 minutes in the second quarter. It was insanity. Loved watching it. Aaron Rodgers still owns the Chicago Bears, and I think he forever will.
Yeah, no kidding. Taysom Hill, Mike started the week. He did it. He did it. He got it done.
He runs. That's all there is to it. He runs, and he's incredibly athletically gifted, so that it's not just someone lumbering down the field every once in a while. When he takes off, he can house it from 50 yards.
Now somehow, some way, all three of our starts of the week were in the studs this week.
For
quarterbacks.
All right.
Rodgers, Hill, and Big Ben.
Yeah.
Now, this was a bad game for him. Right, like he had a 44-yard breakaway touchdown when the game was over. That Alvin Kamara said he should have just sat down and not even scored. take that 44-yard touchdown away, and you know what
more
I mean? Like,
more a lower floor than you would have thought.
Yeah, didn't throw for 200 yards.
He's the number five quarterback.
And he's the number five quarterback. Crazy. I mean, against the Jets.
It was the offensive plan. He threw the ball 21 times. You know, he completed 15 of those passing attempts. They just the game plan was we're going to have Alvin Kamara and our defense take us to victory.
And one name that's not in the doc here, but I want to give a shout-out to, was actually a player that finished in between Big Ben and Taysom this week, at least in our league scoring, which is Justin Fields. Justin Fields ended up with a pretty good game, made some mistakes, obviously, had a couple of interceptions, had a fumble, but also, you know, a couple of big touchdown passes. And
yeah, one was...
Fantasy-wise, he was good.
I mean, one was the tap pass where he didn't really do anything.
The Jakeem Grant one?
Yes. Yeah. Which, oh my...
He's a lightning
bolt. Is he the fastest man alive?
For one night.
Yeah, I mean...
Like, that was unbelievable. Like, he looked like Sonic the Hedgehog was like, whoa, slow down.
Right.
Why are you so fast?
Yeah, that's offensive to Sonic. it's
craziness.
Dalvin Cook at the running back position, 27 for 205. We talked about it, obviously reacting.
The device
himself. I mean, it gives you a lot of excitement going into this fantasy playoffs. You have not the easiest matchup, Chicago, Los Angeles, Green Bay, but it doesn't matter. I mean, he has the identity of the team, and he'll have a ton of opportunities. And I was looking back, you know, he's had an injury-marred year where he's missed, you know, he played for a little while, then he'd miss a game or be hurt. Like, he was getting a lot of opportunities in between these injuries. So you can expect 20-plus opportunities for Dalvin Cook in these matchups, and you hope he, you know, he's leading the league in 15-plus yard runs, so you hope he just breaks one off.
Nobody stops the device.
The device.
Rashad Penny. This was a player. It's nice to see him exist again.
It was great.
I did not think he would ever get over his injured body to get back to a place where he could be this good. Now, maybe it was just the Houston Texans.
That's part of it.
And their poor defense, but he was given the opportunity with Adrian Peterson kind of a late surprise scratch, and he dominated 16 for 137 and 2 on the ground. Are you confident playing him against the Rams?
He's the dude.
Are you confident playing him against the Rams?
I answered the first part, Mike. You get the second.
I am confident that he will be the one that sees the volume, and now that you have the actual proof of concept that the athleticism is still there. Like, he can still hit the home run play. That would give me the confidence to play him as a flex play. And with surprise COVID inactives hitting people all over the place, Rashad Penny would be someone that I would be prioritizing to pick up this week.
All right, Najee Harris, Melvin Gordon, Javonte Williams, big weeks. The Broncos running backs, they got to play Detroit. They received almost 40 total carries between them. Gordon was 24 for 111 and 2.
Yes, and the question of what happens after Javonte Williams' massive breakout game, does that change the balance of the running back attempts? And the answer is yes for Melvin Gordon, who had 62% of the carries. I'm not saying he was bad. He was fantastic. But it just was like,
we said maybe, it on the show.
Maybe the rookie will take over as the lead back, but nope, it's still a split.
And Gordon was better in this one, right?
I don't know.
I mean, you could argue slightly better in this one.
I mean, they're very similar. They were both great. I mean, it's funny because our love for Javonte Williams, which should not be understated, it is massive. It really has overshadowed how good Melvin Gordon has been, not just for fantasy, but like in real life, he's just been out. He's going to get another contract. I'm worried primarily that he's going to get another contract with the Broncos now.
Yeah, if Fangio survives to next year, you could be very right.
Don't do it, Melvin.
That sounds
See, but this is why. This kind of talk.
We're excited. I want Melvin to go and get his own job. I want him to go to a
team. Last week, you wanted him to take an extra week off to rest.
Well, sure, this year, but I'm saying next year. Tell me that the Atlanta Falcons.
I've been trying to tell you Melvin Gordon's good all year long.
That the Atlanta Falcons would not just be 10 times better with Melvin Gordon there.
Yeah. No, you're right. Because Melvin Gordon's a good running back.
Yeah.
That makes me sad.
That he's good.
No. It makes me sad. Like, I haven't fully considered Melvin Gordon back to the Denver Broncos.
Yeah.
And that's a real possibility.
I had thought about it at all, and I doubt it happens. But
it could.
A one-year deal or something stupid?
Oh, no.
Let's talk about Super Camario instead.
Oh, man.
Well, he's back. 27-for-1, 20-and-1. Five targets, 4-for-25. Most carries of the year.
He's good.
Yeah, like most carries of the season. 27 carries. That's what happened to Taysom. They said Alvin Kamara is going to handle the situation. That will not be. It's not probable that that is what they're going to be able to execute against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They may try, but Tampa Bay will put up points, so they'll have to catch up.
Leonard Fournette again, 19-for-113-and-1, fantasy MVP. Is there an argument for that?
Oh, there's certainly an argument for it. You drafted him in. Where was he going?
You drafted him, and you were disgusted when you did it.
Yes,
and he was going late.
Yeah,
he was after Ronald Jones, right?
I think he was probably before Ronald Jones after the playoff run. But they were both.
He was the running back 33 on average behind Ronald Jones, behind Trey Sermon, behind Damian Harris, Gus Edwards, Raheem Mostert.
He's RB4 in the year.
Yeah, he was. He was in half PPR, 8th round.
Okay.
Definitely in consideration. And not only, you know, we just talked about with Melvin Gordon, not just saying it's situation or that he's good for fantasy, but he's been playing well. It needs to be said for Leonard Fournette, because we've made a lot of jokes about Leonard Fournette over the years being a volume play, and he just touchdowns or receives, you know, enough receptions to be fantasy relevant. But he's just looking good.
Yes.
I mean, people aren't catching him. He's breaking tackles. He's looking strong.
They have the best offensive line in football, too, in my opinion. And so he is you're right. He's looked great. You know, last year Ronald Jones was the running back 16 in fantasy football. And he's completely just made him fully irrelevant. They're committed to Fournette. Aaron Jones back. I mean, what do you make of this performance? This is what you get this year, right? What do you have, 8 touches in the game, but he scored twice.
Holy crap.
5-for-35.
What?
Yeah.
What?
Unless I'm misreading the line here.
No, you are not, but I watched the game.
5-for-35, 8 total opportunities. Opportunities for Aaron Jones in his last 3 starts, 13-11-8.
He doesn't need much.
No.
But it didn't seem like he was an afterthought. It seemed
like he was an
important part.
A lot of snaps, not a lot of touches.
It was also a very weird game. I mean, the points went so quick, defensive touchdowns and special teams touchdowns. It's kind of a bizarro.
But that is certainly troubling as you move into the playoffs here, because A.J. Dillon had 15 carries. And if watching the game with just the gigantic human monster that AJ Dillon is in the cold, like you can feel the pain that he is inflicting upon the defenders as he hits them while it's 30 degrees. And thinking about trying to tackle him in that is a situation, and I think that's where they're shifting here. You know, winter ball turns into running, and playoffs, you got to establish the run a little bit more as well. So that the timeshare is going to be real for Aaron Jones, and if he doesn't get the touchdowns, I think you might be disappointed.
The running back starts of the week worked out this week too. Javonte was one, Leonard Fournette, and then Clyde Edwards-Helaire, 2 touchdowns. He took a similar Aaron Jones efficiency model. That game was kind of out of hand early.
Very early.
13 total opportunities, had 2 touchdowns, 10 for 37 on the ground. You like to see the touchdowns because that was something that he struggled with. And then Saquon, you know, 3 for 31, had a touchdown, 16 for 64 on the ground. It's a good performance.
Yeah.
Probably the best you can expect, really, right now out of Saquon in that offense. At wide receiver,
Hot Lockett.
He's been playing great. Tyler Lockett, another big bomb touchdown. It seems like, you know, Russell Wilson can connect with him right now down the field, and something goes wrong when he's trying to connect with Metcalf. I mean, the touchdown was called back for Metcalf, a couple deep bombs. One was a penalty where he was going to have a touchdown.
Right.
One was a slant that he was wide open and he was missed, but Lockett has Russ's laser-focused.
He had the 5-game stretch where he was irrelevant in the offense. He was actively harming your roster, but in the last 6 weeks, he has one dud and a bunch of great games.
So going into the fantasy playoffs, is he spreading the leaves over the trap so that you don't, or is this
making
like
a pungy
or
pit?
Is it time to just? I mean, I think you probably are just. He's so valuable when he hits like this. That you take your chance at
that. Yeah, I think you got to roll with him.
But man, the odds of getting 3 of those in a row in the fantasy playoffs.
It's not going to happen. You're not going to get 3 in a row.
Right.
But hopefully, you know, he's not your wide receiver 1, and you can overcome a 5 or 6 point week from one of those weeks with your other options. But I would just be surprised if you lucked into
Weeks. Let's play a game here, Jason. Let's say that there was 3 boxes. Okay.
Okay.
And 2 of the boxes had $1 million in them, and 1 had a tarantula inside.
Holy crap.
And then so this is the Lockett situation.
I did not see this coming.
So we mix them all up, mm-hmm. and then you get to open a box. Now the odds.
It's not open. You just have to put your hand in.
But the odds are, I mean, 2/3 odds. I mean, let's give Lockett.
Lockett's going on my bench, baby. I'm not playing with that nonsense. You could take your $1 million and light it on fire.
Now, if I change that to a scorpion, does it change anything?
Oh, absolutely.
So you'll put your hand in a scorpion box?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
I'll get a scorpion sting.
Shoot for the $1 million?
Tyler Lockett is 34 yards away from his career high. Like,
Russ for part of the year.
That's how good the season has been for Lockett here.
Yeah, and the reality is
seasons were.
his terrible stretch, you know, when he was unusable, those 3 of those games were Geno Smith.
He could redeem his entire reputation at these 3 playoff games.
He could.
Yeah.
Might happen. They're going to be fighting. They're going to be fighting for that. You know, they won again. They're going to be fighting for the wild card.
I would, all jokes aside, I would be playing Tyler Lockett. I wouldn't be reaching for tarantulas, though, ever.
Okay. How many boxes would it take to play the game?
Oh man.
Right, like there's only 1 tarantula box.
Holy crap.
And I could add as many boxes of $1 million. Like how many
1 in 10?
Ten boxes?
No, you're talking 100 boxes.
100 boxes, you'd go for it.
I might.
Oh my gosh.
I might.
Okay, 100 boxes, there's only 1 with a spider, 99 with $1 million, and you get to go as long as you want.
Oh man.
You get to
keep
going.
Once, because I will either die or I will stop with $1 million.
Oh my gosh. Jamar Chase.
Oh, the variance.
5 for 77 and 2. Jason or Mike start of the week. Hunter Renfrow, 14 targets, 13 for 117 and 1.
That dude is amazing.
You cannot
stop him. And since the injury, you know, losing Ruggs, never having Bryan Edwards and having lost Darren Waller, Hunter Renfrow's unstoppable. Like nobody can guard Hunter Renfrow. He doesn't have the athletic profile that can just go and take over a game and dominate. But if you're talking about
13
he is Cooper Kupp light.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's Cooper Kupp light. He really is.
You know, I think I need to start viewing him more as like a Wes Welker in his prime, where it's just so consistent, so common, and he can get a deep shot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they do sneak him out and leak him down the field.
A sneak and leak.
A sneak and leak, as I call it.
The old sneak and leak.
Let me give you a number.
Would you rather have Hunter Renfrow
or
Tyler Lockett for the playoffs?
Give me Hunter Renfrow.
Me too.
Let me give you the 6-game Last six games, Hunter Renfrow is on pace for 155 targets, 136 catches, 1,354 yards, and 8.5 touchdowns.
What is that catch percentage then? That's got to be
87%. 87%. And his you know, yards per catch, I mean, he's had some good games in there. He's 16.8, 11, you know.
Can't guard Mike. I mean, that's what it seems like. Like, this stretch is, you know, is Michael Thomas.
Do you have his? Do you have the box score up, Andy? His?
What do you mean?
His game log.
Yeah, I have his game log.
Okay, what did he do in week 11 against the Bengals?
That was his worst game in the stretch.
Okay.
It's 4 for 30.
And you know what that completely correlated with? Darren Waller.
Like, yeah.
Darren Waller in week 11, 7 for 116. But surrounded by that was week 10, Waller 24 yards. Week 12, Waller 33 yards. I mean,
well, and you also had the the bye week. They came out of the bye week and no more Henry Ruggs too, right?
But I'm saying the impact of Waller and the impact that Waller has on Renfrow here, I think it's a real thing. And can they both really thrive in the same exact game? That I'm not sure.
It does seem like there is a, yeah, thrive, maybe not, but it seems like there's a nice floor for Renfrow, and I wish I had him. I mean, like, I wish I had him over Devontae Smith to finish this year out. I wish I had him over, you know, a lot of players.
Yes.
So Devontae Adams, huge game, 2 touchdowns. He was awesome. Mike Evans, another touchdown, 6 for 91. Robbie Anderson, 12 targets, 7 for 84 and a touchdown.
What?
There he is.
I'm not going to chase that.
No, you're not.
Justin Jefferson, we talked about the Thursday game, the best worst game, 7 for 79 mm-hmm. and 1. 15 targets though. Not a Hunter Renfrow catch percentage there. And then Alan Lazard last night, 6 for 75 and 1, just to further twist the knife on Mike, who played MVS.
Yep.
Jalen Guyton, who took care of business for me.
Caught his deep bomb.
And one of us is getting the shame this week, and it's not me.
And it's not me.
And it's not me.
I'm leaving the show.
This week, well, I've got an idea for you, Mike.
Oh.
It's a good one.
Okay.
Yeah. Fun.
KJ Osborne caught a deep pass. I mean, Guyton and Osborne were both waiver wire pickups, and they both delivered with one huge play. So it doesn't matter how it happens.
Yeah,
but the
Rashad Perryman says,
"Oh my gosh!"
Oh yes,
the
final play of the game,
the full goose final play of all of them,
of overtime.
Yeah, just walk off home run.
The nice thing here for KJ Osborne, it was, if you look at just the actual production, 3 for 81 and 1. Number one, that's off of the wire to your team. That's fantastic. But 9 targets while Adam Thielen is out, I think that KJ Osborne is. He's safe for volume, and he can hit a big play. So he becomes very interesting as a wide receiver 3.
There is a there's a man in the building.
Wait, you're giving that to Kittle?
I move it between them.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I've always imagined that Debo and Kittle are both out there with the huge saw cutting down the trees. Like, there's got to be somebody on both sides of that saw.
I don't know if you've seen, when they're on the sideline, they're working out.
Right.
They're just literally doing bicep curls on the sideline, and then
it's like Santa Monica Beach.
Yeah,
like,
and then they run in, and then they come on out. And yeah, doing squats. It's crazy. He was unstoppable. And
13, 151 and 1.
There were a couple catches in this game that were impossible, and he leaped. Yes.
He is the tight end 3 on the year in 10 games played. This is why you didn't move on from George Kittle.
Mm-hmm.
Because he has the chance. If he plays like this, you don't lose. You get this game at tight end, you don't lose. Ever. And Mark Andrews is nearly in that category every week. 11 for 115 and 1. Tight end 1 on the year.
Yeah, he has overtaken Travis Kelce fantasy points wise. And how it used to happen was, oh, that means he just got a ton of touchdowns. He is tied with Travis Kelce for targets.
Mike.
Yes.
Put Kittle, Andrews, and Kelce in order to finish the year.
Oh, my gosh.
Who would you rather have?
Well, George Kittle gets to play the Falcons, Tennessee, and Houston.
Oh, my gosh. This was the schedule you wanted for Lance.
This is the Trey Lance playoff schedule.
They're going to make the playoffs for sure.
So I'm going with – I would put Kittle at the top. I don't know if Lamar is good to go or not with the ankle, even though, I mean, Andrews got this done without him. And the Kansas City offense, they're not back to me. Like, the Raiders stubbornly decided that they would not go with the two safety approach in either game against Kansas City, and that turned into 40-plus points for Kansas City in both of those games, while the other teams are able to at least slow them down. I think I'm taking Andrews over Kelce at this point.
I think that's fair. And then
I don't like it.
Dawson Knox, 7 for 60 and a touchdown. Emmanuel Sanders, don't know if he's going to be out longer, but Dawson Knox is very secure in that next tier.
He has leveled up to me for sure.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. And the touchdowns are coming, you know, his way a lot. So leading all tight ends with 8 of them. Austin Hooper had a touchdown. That's
nice.
I mean, we looked at the tight ends in the middle of yesterday, and it was like...
It was Andrews, Hooper, and then a list of 8 players that no one in fantasy plays.
Yeah, we were talking about the streaming options or the middle tier guys that you would have picked up and played, and it's like, oh, no, Conklin had a bad game. Oh, no, RSJ had a bad... But it's like they all... If you didn't have Kittle or Andrews or Knox, you had a bad game.
Let's move on.
Pooped in his big boy pants.
Well, there were some big boy pants with heavy loads. And tell me if you're worried. Dak Prescott.
Oh, I thought you wanted the immediate answer.
Go for it.
I am not worried about Dak Prescott. Bad back-to-back weeks.
I'm worried.
Are you?
I am.
Is it because the only reason that I would have to worry is how good their defense is?
No, I'm worried because he's not – ever since he's come back from that injury, I mean, look at the last 4 weeks. He had one really big week against the Raiders that just looked ridiculous on defense. But Kansas City, 28th-ranked quarterback. New Orleans, 21st. Washington, 21st. Some inexplicable passes. I think that something's – you know, we had the ankle. We had the – was it the ankle or the
– calf.
It was a calf.
For Dak?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he has not seemed the same to me.
I don't think it's an injury thing. He hasn't really, to me, looked bad. They just haven't needed him that much. You had a couple, you know, games with...
needed him in Kansas City.
Sure. Kansas City's defense has been just so, so good lately. I mean... when I say I'm not worried, I don't see Dak as a top three guy, but I definitely think he is still. I mean, I would be happy with Dak in the playoffs. Would you be worried and looking to pivot? Would you be streaming off of Dak?
Like, would you go to Taysom?
Sure.
I'd still stick with Dak.
Okay.
But I'm
a little worried. I am. I'm worried he may disappoint fans. I mean, if you're in the playoffs, you're gonna be facing some juggernaut situations, probably some Herbert, and we'll see. We'll see what happens. You might not have a streaming option better than Dak. I mean, that's for sure. Running back disappointments. James Robinson had 6 carries for 4 yards. He plays Houston and the Jets the next 2 weeks, which look like smash matchups. How healthy he is, I don't know. How healthy mentally Urban Meyer is, I don't know. The matchups say you've got to probably play him.
Yes.
So
unless you're going through the week and we're back to James Robinson's not practicing Wednesday, he's not practicing on Thursday, we think he's going to play, then maybe you can have some other break glass situation. But I'm going to play Robinson against the Houston Texans.
Antonio Gibson, 10 for 36. A huge disappointment. They lost the game.
Another fumble.
Another fumble where he got benched. And, I mean, who's to say that didn't cost him the game when it came right down to it? Philadelphia, Dallas, Philadelphia coming up. You think Heineke's okay, but he's been playing bad. It's scary.
It is.
Because if they show up, right, it's like, does Washington show up to the game? If they show up, Gibson's a big part of it. If they don't show up, your floor seems real low.
Yeah, and I would say that Philadelphia is a – much, much better matchup for Washington than Dallas was. Dallas is in 2 weeks again, so you might be scared there. but you've got Philadelphia two of the next 3 weeks. So I'm terrified of Gibson, like, because he could fumble and just be benched for the game, but I will be starting him and just holding my breath that he holds on to the ball.
Are you more scared of Robinson or Gibson?
I am more scared of Gibson because I think a fumble could just end his entire I think another one is, like, he's been coming back after small punishments, but at a certain point it's not a punishment anymore. We can't give the ball to him. We can't do this to our team. We're losing possessions.
I'm going to have to differ in my opinion for facing the Eagles defense. Let me give you the fantasy points that they've given up to the running back position. Week 9, 11. Week 10, 14. Week 11, 13 points. Then 10, then 13. They've been stout against the run. And this is not pushovers. 14 points to Denver and those two running backs. 11 points to the Chargers.
So they have a good run D, but let me ask you this, Andy. Who would you take to win those games? Do you think Washington has a good chance to win?
I'd be picking Philly.
So when I say, like, the matchup is better, what I'm saying is we've talked a lot lately about when Washington is up, when they're in a game, when they can continue to use Gibson, they're just going to – it's very Josh Jacobs. Like, the win-loss is kind of the matchup you're looking for versus just, you know, is it easy to run or not? Because if he gets the ball 20 times and he's inefficient, he probably ends up with a fine fantasy day.
Okay. I'm worried about him too, Mike. Where do you weigh in?
I'm still playing Gibson.
Ezekiel Elliott. Rushing totals for Zeke over the last 7 games, 50, 51, 42, 32, 25, 45, 45. 12 for 45 in this game, Giants, Washington, Arizona. Zeke might be the worst player on Al Borland's team.
Yeah, you got to be worried. I mean, you watch the game and he's limping around. I mean, three or four times that game, it just looked like he couldn't move anymore.
Right, and now you have, like, Corey Clement had 15 opportunities in this game because Tony Pollard has the partially torn fascia and the fascia bread injury, and because of that, like, they can't really rest Zeke. They need the whatever percentage that he's at, 50%, 60%. So you can't have the game off for Zeke. This is a really rough situation. If you're counting on Zeke to carry you through the playoffs, it's very troubling.
Nick Chubb, Joe Mixon, Josh Jacobs, Jeff Wilson. In some ways, Wilson kind of got it going later, 13 for 56. That's like the best he's done this year. Jermichael Hasty didn't have a carry.
And Wilson looked like a better play around Thursday, where he's like, okay, Elijah Mitchell is trending out. Jeff Wilson's going to be the guy. Debo probably not going to play.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this, you got to stay with the news up until.
And Debo
Sunday.
Had another rushing touchdown.
That's what I'm saying. Of
Debo's a great running.
Debo's a sensational all around player.
He had 8 carries.
But if Debo had been out, I think Jeff Wilson then has a monster game. But when Debo's taking all these high value touches, it takes away from what Jeff can do.
Okay, any other thoughts on those running backs? Wide receiver duds. DK Metcalf, four for 43. Had a touchdown called back. Had some targets, just hasn't connected. So that was a big dud against Houston. Thought he'd have a huge game. Are you worried about him into the fantasy playoffs? Or do you kind of chalk it up to circumstance?
I mean, that's
5 straight weeks he's been bad.
Yeah,
bad.
But in 4 of those 5 weeks, he's had 8 targets.
Yeah, so they say 122 target pace in those weeks.
The volume has not transferred away from him, so I would continue to play him with confidence. But five bad, it doesn't make sense for a man of his stature, 6'4", 235 pounds.
It's a lot.
Usually the fastest guy on the field, that he can just poof and disappear from the offense makes no sense.
It reminds me a lot of what happened to Ja'Marr Chase before the return
the breakout
this week. Because there were two touchdowns in this game that were like there's a walk in that
on the slant?
Yeah, that Russ threw behind him, you know, he was wide open, and then the one you guys talked about with the maybe the holding penalty caused it, but he had a touchdown called back. It's a little scary though when you go into the playoffs with him as your one or your two. Darnell Mooney, just 5 targets, 1 for 19.
Oof, that was bread pudding. that was not a good moon. If you told me that the Bears are going to put up 30 points in Lambeau, oh, man. I mean, I already liked Mooney, but very disappointing. The tiny speedsters got all the work in this one.
Hollywood Brown, 5 for 41. He's not been in the top 30 since week 9. And now you got to move forward with no confidence if you don't have Lamar.
Yeah, I would be looking to bench Brown without Lamar.
Jamison Crowder, 6 targets, 3 for 19. It's so hard to watch Zach Wilson play football. Like, I know he has arm talent, but he misses so he misses so many easy throws that can move the sticks that these drives don't get strung together, and it's infuriating.
The scramble around
where he rolls to the right.
Well, no, there was that throw that he missed. No, but where the pocket's collapsing on him, and he's looking for his check down and does a shovel pass, except he does a shovel pass to a completely empty field.
There's nobody there. And the shovel pass is not like a normal shovel pass. He just kind of shoots the ball out to the right. It was like, what happened? But
he was a desperate man.
Called for grounding on that play, but it was very funny.
Julio Jones, 4 for 33. Any confidence at all into the fantasy playoffs?
I actually do have some confidence. He on his first game back from the injury, he only played 45% of the snaps, but his targets per route run was very solid. So as he is healthy and acclimates, I think he will be into that number one wide receiver position for the team. They destroyed Jacksonville. Like, it was 20-0 at the end of the game, but Jacksonville had no chance in this contest. And it was okay. We got Julio out there. We have him running around, and he's healthy. We don't need him. We don't need to press him this week. Let's save him for Pittsburgh.
I'd play Julio over Jerry Jeudy.
Yeah.
5 for 47 for Jerry Jeudy.
Oh, yeah.
I'd play him over Kenny Galladay.
Oh,
that is a new yes.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Oh, no.
Two at the same time.
The double up.
That's great audio.
Oh, great!
How did I do that?
That is good audio. But
we haven't hit the smooth button all year.
Our normal. Players get sound effects from this show, like when Tyler Conklin catches it, you conk. Gronk is, which rhymes, is gronk. Kenny Galladay now, just every target is.
It was a lot of fun.
I mean, talk about, how much money did he get? $80 million or something?
A lot.
It's just a lost season.
Yes. Can he bounce back?
88% of snaps, 8 targets. You see those targets. Can he bounce back?
Yeah, what's the confidence in him for
not high because of the recurrence of injuries over years?
And I would say not high because Daniel Jones. Like, if they trade for Russell Wilson, I'll be in on Kenny Galladay. If they have Daniel Jones, no way.
Yeah, and I still like Kadarius Toney more moving forward in general. So it's like we were talking about that in the office. Jason's like, oh, what if Russ goes there? Where would you put Kenny G? And I'll be like, 17-18, you know, probably our wide receiver 2 range with upside, with potential.
Sure.
But who does, you know, who would Russ attach to? And of course Russ says he wants to be there for the long term.
In Seattle.
Unlimited.
Travis Kelce, Dalton Schultz, Ricky Seals Jones, Tyler Conklin.
Tight ends.
We want to thank Pristine Auction for supporting the show. Deontay Johnson, a signed jersey right now, $42. Get a sweet gift over there at pristineauction.com. Use code BALLERS.
Ballers.
Get a $10 credit. That'll do it for today. And we'll be back tomorrow. Waivers.
Playoffs.
A lot of fun stuff going on.
Enjoy the Cardinals tonight, everybody. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter at the FF Ballers.
Also want to thank Omaha Steaks, because who doesn't want to thank Omaha Steaks? I thank them when it arrives, and I thank them once I've eaten all of my Omaha Steaks. Visit omahasteaks.com, enter the code FOOTBALLERS in the search bar, save over 50% when you order the perfect gift package. Not only do you save over 50%, they'll give you 8 Omaha Steaks burgers for free. 8 of them.
That's a lot.
That's omahasteaks.com, keyword FOOTBALLERS.